Corporation, delivering the music of today coupled with the technology of tomorrow.
Coming up next, the new explorers are lost in a galaxy far, far away.
Wednesday night at 7:30.
Monday night's broadcast schedule is brought to you in part by Rotlin Homes and Rotlin Town Homes, innovators in design and lasting value, your builder for life in the Twin Cities. Deluxe Corporation, maker of PrintWise, environmentally advanced lithographic ink. The Bayport Foundation, supported by Anderson Corporation and by the members of Channel 2.
Hi, this is Lenny Kravitz, and you're watching Channel 2.
Environment and science programming on Channel 2 is brought to you by Braun Intertech, engineers and scientists serving the built and natural environments. Aveda, creators of hair care, beauty, and environmental products from pure flower and plant essences. Ecolab, a worldwide supplier of cleaning, sanitizing, and maintenance products and services. And by American Medical Systems and Schneider USA, two Pfizer medical device companies serving the needs of patients and physicians with innovative medical products.
The New Explorers has traveled the world, tracking scientists who are stretching the frontiers of discovery. The journeys have taken us a long way from the test tubes and laboratories of a science hall and have been filled with excitement and adventure.
Wow, what an experience. Look at that, unbelievable, look at here.
It's hot. Okay.
It's incredible, especially from this view.
This time, our time machine catapults us into the future for a glimpse of the computer advancements that are sure to continue to expand our lives, of how science fiction has led to science fact, transforming the make-believe into reality that is already reshaping the medical field.
This really just makes it a lot easier at this stage. Not having used it before at this stage, I didn't know, but it really does.
And of how the big daddy of them all, the $12 million supercomputer, transforms cold numbers and data at the rate of 2 to 4 billion calculations a second into wonderfully sophisticated animations for attacking problems in everything from art and architecture to pollution and weather.
Major funding for the New Explorers is provided by Amoco, celebrating the adventure of scientific discovery for the year 2000 and beyond. Additional funding is made possible by Waste Management Incorporated, providing recycling and other waste services around the world. And by Duracell, embracing the power of science education, the source of future technology and innovative growth. Duracell, the copper top battery.
Hello, I'm Bill Curtis. Welcome to this special presentation of the New Explorers. What you're about to see are glimpses into the future. Computer wizardry is so spectacular. It can take millions of numbers and equations and turn them into moving panoramas in the time it takes me to finish this sentence. Transforming data into moving pictures. The notion is quite spectacular, especially when you can beam up those pictures into an operating room to help save a life. It's the stuff of Star Wars, turned into real life.
Here goes nothing.
This is the world of Lucasfilm, a strange and wonderful family that lives only in our imagination. That's why it's ironic that their most unusual episode isn't science fiction at all. Luke Skywalker might tell the story this way. One day, in a galaxy far, far away, the Wookiees and droids and heroes sent a gift to the 20th century Earth. It was a magical new tool that enabled the people to see things as they had never seen them before. First appeared, a team of computer wizards used it to look at everything, for they were seeing inside living things in three dimension for the first time. It seemed like it would be helpful to people who had to go places where they could not really see, like the hidden universe inside the human body. And so the people who used the gift live day and night, peering into another world, each day discovering something new. Like new explorers, they were walking into a new frontier. And the most amazing thing is that this story is true. In the early days of Hollywood, they called it trick photography. While it dazzled the audience, it did require a little help from the imagination. But it was clear where the dream makers were heading, and it needed a new name to match the achievement. Special effects. And so they created and refined their craft. Until finally, in the mid-70s, a young filmmaker named George Lucas introduced us to a sci-fi trilogy called Star Wars. And there was no question he had reached another dimension in special effects. The movie Star Wars grossed $200 million and enabled Lucas to live out another dream, to make an even larger leap forward in special effects with his own special effects company, Industrial Light and Magic.
We've always been pushing ourselves. So we look at something and we're envisioning what we want to do, and we never quite get us anywhere near what we envisioned, you know. I mean, Star Wars, George has always said, is, I don't know, 30 or 40% of what he wanted, and the next one's maybe 50, and the next one's maybe 60 or 70. So that we're just pushing ourselves. It's hard to, we don't like to sit back and go, oh, that was wonderful. We just go, okay, well, we made it through that one. What's the next challenge?
The idea was to develop new tools to express Lucas's imagination. So in addition to the traditional tools, he came up with a computer division, and he called it the Pixar team.
Isn't that great, though? It's amazing.
They came from the high-tech world. animators from other studios, and hot young whiz kids were even recruited right out of college into a world of pure creativity.
So what program are we looking at?
This is part of the dynamic program later also.
Bob Drebin of Chicago was one of the chosen, recruited out of Brown University when he was only 20. A former high school football player, he never thought much about computers until college.
I was never really into schoolwork. I was not a bookworm or a math, you know, nerd or computer scientist or anything, but I was more of an outdoors person.
But at Brown, he took a computer graphics course that changed his life.
Once I was a junior, I was spending all my time doing computer graphics at the expense of my other classes, and then went on and knew I would do something in computers. I think Lucasfilm was probably, you know, a dream come true.
The seductive joys of California would be enough to fill a dream, but like the other computer virtuosos, he was thrilled by the opportunities waiting at Lucasfilm. He arrived just as the studio was starting work on a new film. It was a moment of history in special effects. If successful, it would be a breakthrough in using computer-generated images on the big screen.
Well, it'd be cool if it was like
Bob Drebin would work on the software, the instructions that tell a computer what to do. And John Lasseter, a former Disney animator, would use it to turn George Lucas's imagination into reality.
Hello, is anybody there?
The project was a movie called Young Sherlock Holmes, and it would be a true test for the young computer wizards at Industrial Light and Magic. One reason computer graphics hadn't worked before was that special effects usually are inserted into a real scene, and if they aren't perfect, the contrast can look false and doesn't work. In Young Sherlock Holmes, the scene is shot in a real 18th century church in England. The director wanted a stained glass window to come alive.
When they came to us and asked us if we could do it in computer animation, I was very excited. And the group that I work with, we felt like we could do it. But there was a lot of people who doubted it because it was trying to reproduce 18th century stained glass. You know, and to do anything that's old with computer animation is very difficult. Generally, the computer likes things to be new and fresh.
John Lasseter started with a storyboard depicting a knight made of stained glass. But frankly, it looked more like he was made of gingerbread than glass. So they tried mosaics and then built a wireframe figure. It took 6 months to develop the software, which would produce a stained glass look.
Each piece of glass had 7 texture maps for it, distorting some different aspect of it, the color, the transparency, the bumpiness. It took a long time to get sort of the right combination of texture maps, but it was, I think, a real exciting new development. That there were some people who work in special effects that did not know how we created the stained glass man. They had to wait until the credits at the end of the film to find out it was done by a computer.
The stained glass man helped young Sherlock Holmes win an Academy Award nomination for special effects. Computers had broken through, but the Lucas team only found new challenges waiting for them. Their goal was to make computer images that were as close to reality as possible. Considering nature has had a head start of several billion years, that's no small task. Something as simple as a wave was extremely difficult to recreate with computer graphics.
That's one of the problems for computers, isn't it? To try and reconstruct the randomness of nature,
right.
I guess.
Right, because there is, because reality does have a lot of randomness, and trying to simulate that in a way which, I mean, there's certain randomness, but there's also a certain order, and that's really the difficulty, and it's hard to grasp exactly how it's random and how it's consistent.
With every new breakthrough, they learn secrets which made the images more real. For instance, shadows. Simple little shadows. When John Lasseter used their software to create a short feature with shadows following his characters, it became the first computer-generated film to be nominated for an Academy Award. The computer graphics team was making such spectacular headway, George Lucas thought it might have potential beyond making movies. So while Han Solo and Luke Skywalker were battling to save the universe in one part of the film studio, Bob Drebin and the computer team started to pierce the veil of another dimension with a special gift from the world of make-believe.
I was given a volume of data from CAT scan. A CAT scan study, and medical company said, what can you do with our data? So they gave us the data, we brought it in, and then we started looking at the data. We didn't know what we were looking at. It looked like a bunch of slices.
In fact, it looked just like the computer slices that created a scene from the movie Star Trek II, The Wrath of Khan. What we see as a planet catching fire in space is really a composite of four computer images, layered one on top of the other. First a background of stars in space, then we add the planet, then a spark of fire, according to the movie script, to create life, and finally, the computer layers on a shockwave, again by compositing several elements. The computer team creates an animated scene. And then it seemed natural for the Pixar whiz kids to put the two ideas together. If they could create a three-dimensional view of a burning planet by layering the effects one over each other, why couldn't they layer the CAT scan slices Bob had received from the medical company and come up with a three-dimensional view of the body? It wasn't the kind of work you would expect a movie special effects team to be doing, but Lucas had told his computer whizzes to reach for the stars, no matter where it led them. So the team began working night and day.
Did you even know what this was when you were looking at it?
We knew it was a medical image, but we certainly didn't know what part of the body it was from.
We knew that we had this notion, it should basically work. We had those elements, and we placed one layer on top of each layer to create this image.
Using the principle from the science fiction
movie. Exactly, doing the compositing effect.
Are you expecting anything at this point?
We're hopeful, but we've had data sets before that we were unable to make any sense out of it whatsoever.
And finally, the combination seemed right. They programmed the computer to work on the CAT scans overnight, and when they arrived the next morning, as if by magic, they had created a three-dimensional, high-resolution image that would allow doctors to see muscles, veins, tumors clearer than they had ever seen them before.
It is unbelievable. So what did you do? Did you cheer? Did you break out champagne? Did you sit and look at it?
I think we're all stunned, and more and more we just said, we just got people.
Yeah, we got everybody in the building to come and look at it.
They were consumed by their creation, playing with it like children with a new toy, not yet fully comprehending its potential. Their curiosity took them beyond the office to their hobbies. Bob Drebin often went to the Marine Mammal Center in the Highlands near San Francisco and was soon studying pictures of a sea otter.
What have we learned, really, from looking at the reconstruction of the 3D image of the sea otter?
The professors who were looking at them, they learned both one reason why they die of heart attacks, because of pounding the abalone on their chest. When they saw the reconstruction, they saw the chest being pushed in and the pressure that was putting on the heart, and then they realized that that really was one of the causes.
Well, now there is really contributing something, not only to the world of computers, but here to marine mammals.
Yeah, I think so.
That's a good feeling,
yeah,
isn't it?
It is, yeah.
It was clear Pixar had a future that went beyond movie special effects. So George Lucas, realizing what it could do, turned it out into the real world as its own independent company. It's 8 a.m. on a Wednesday morning. Doctors at the University of Chicago Medical Center are performing history-making surgery on Fran Slayton, 49-year-old mother of nine.
Just hold a stitch for a moment.
The problem began a year ago when Fran experienced numbness and uncontrollable shaking.
I started having tingling tinges in my face, and then it kept on happening more periodically. Then finally, about December 17th, I had a grand mal seizure, so then I knew something was really wrong then.
After Dr. Sean Mullen looked at all the diagnostic tests, he advised surgery. But the MRIs, magnetic resonance images, revealed that Fran had a brain tumor near her skull.
Now, we do expect to be able to remove this totally. We can see the limits of the tumor. We believe it's free from the important areas.
Today, Dr. Mullen and his team will remove the tumor. And in this operation, Fran will have a little extra help because Dr. Mullen will be using, for the first time at the University of Chicago, a television screen which will show him a three-dimensional image of Fran's brain generated by a Pixar computer.
That end of it sure comes right up to
Right up to her.
Well, right up to the motor cortex, I would say.
What are you looking for?
We're just correlating the information we've gotten from the electrical study with the three-dimensional image.
Bob Drebin has come in for the operation. He's been helping the University of Chicago team learn how to use Pixar and make the transition from theory to surgery. Teaching is always a two-way street. This is also Bob's first operation.
Can you tell anything by its overall shape?
I don't think it's shape.
I think before coming in, we see the tumor on the Pixar screen. We see the abnormal part, and the goal is to get it out. When you see here, they spend so much time being careful of what they don't hear. And that seems like the real challenge in this work.
Dr. Mullen has been interested but guarded about using Pixar in his operating room. He was eager to try out a new medical tool, but he wasn't sure how this one was going to help until he used it.
This really just makes it a lot easier at this stage. Not having used it before at this stage, I didn't know, but it really does. It gives me a nice slope.
Seems to me it's giving you information.
It's giving me... it would be difficult before.
Because it's the first operation to use the Pixar computer at the University of Chicago, the image reflects an early learning stage. But for the next journey into surgery, the images will be dramatically improved, perhaps as clear as these, from Johns Hopkins University in Baltimore, Maryland, where three separate Pixar systems are in operation, making it almost as commonplace as an X-ray. Dr. Elliot Fishman was working with the Pixar team on its new tool as soon as they completed it. In some ways, it's his baby too, and he enjoys watching his colleagues discover it for themselves.
I guess you might think at first, or at least we thought maybe since they were a quote-unquote movie company, maybe they wouldn't be taken seriously. But once you saw one of the images generated by their system, all doubt went away. With the Pixar, all you do is show the image and be quiet and try to peel them off the ceiling.
A year and a half ago, it took 18 hours for Dr. Fishman to take a Pixar image. Now at Johns Hopkins, it's done in 1 minute. He's used Pixar more than anyone else, and almost every image is an exploration into a new world. This is the first picture of a lung to show the bronchial tree. It's impossible to see this detail on X-rays. A kidney. With this new high-resolution picture, a doctor can remove only the tumor or injured area instead of having to remove the entire kidney. A chest wall, where you can see the sutures from a previous operation. As the image rotates, it provides a window right into the heart.
We did a study where we had orthopedic surgeons, you know, very experienced people, and we showed them the classic information. They would get routine CT scans and said, okay, based on this information, what would you do? And they can write down, well, I would do this, that, or the other. And then we said, okay, now let's show you the Pixar study. Here's more information. What would you do now? Well, in about 30% of the time, they change their mind. And so, if a surgeon is going to change his mind, that means he's going to do a better surgery in your case.
And that's just where the doctors need it, to be used as easily as an X-ray and provide a new set of eyes, a new map into places where they cannot see.
How's Grandma's girl? You a good girl, huh?
Fran Slayton made a complete recovery, not even knowing that her surgery was part of a new exploration into the future that will make it easier for other patients. And the Pixar team continued to grow and flourish and even divide. In May of 1990, Viacom Incorporated purchased part of Pixar, including the medical imaging program, and the breakthroughs continued. Doctors at the University of Washington Medical School are using it to search for a cause of Alzheimer's disease. At the University of Southern California, Pixar is helping doctors pinpoint a more accurate form of radiation therapy. Some of the most advanced medical imaging is coming from the University of Chicago, where Fran Slayton's surgery was done. Using the Pixar computer, Dr. David Levin and his team have invented a way to see motor and sensory areas of the brain for the first time. They've also created a map of epileptic behavior in the brain to give surgeons an anatomical guide of where to operate. And they are testing an invention they call the localizer device, a wand that, when pointed at a patient, gives doctors a 3D image of the brain, allowing them to map lesions or mark sites for incisions. The first tests are being done now. The rest of the Pixar family is focusing on computer graphics. They're now selling the same software the computer animation team uses to the public. As for John Lasseter and the team, they continue to turn out the best in computer animated films. Tin Toy won the Academy Award for Best Animated Short Film in 1988. And Knick Knack is already being cited for animation excellence. The truth is, when George Lucas created Pixar, he gave us more than even he could have bargained for. Luke Skywalker might argue that the Pixar story really did begin in a galaxy far, far away, where the strange and wonderful family of Lucasfilm gave birth to its most intriguing episode yet, where science fiction became science fact, and the world of the imagination produced a special force which just might change the course of medical science.
In the tradition of the old carnival barker, you ain't seen nothing yet. Here's where we get into the supercomputers. It's kind of mind-boggling to realize that only until recently the United States government had them so restricted, many of our brightest minds had to travel overseas to do any research with them. Our new Explorer helped to change that, and at the same time opened up tremendous new possibilities, not only for scientists and researchers, but also for people like you and me.
Your eyes may burn at the very thought of Los Angeles smog, but try looking at it another way. If a picture is worth 1,000 words, then this one is worth 1,000,000,000 numbers. Using a supercomputer, scientists take equations that describe LA pollution and turn them into images that are easier for everyone to understand.
Debris, tornado, that's right in front of us.
In the same way, severe weather becomes moving mosaics of spheres and ribbons. Molecules are turned into frenetic dancing patterns, and centuries of earthquake activity condensed into colorful pulsations. These brilliant pictures are giving scientists a new intuitive understanding of their data that endless sheets of numbers could never provide. With supercomputers, our new Explorer is answering questions which otherwise would not be asked, and teaching a new language of science. If we gaze into a crystal ball, the story goes, we can see into the future. Today, with the help of the world's fastest and most expensive computers, scientists are discovering and exploring worlds they've never seen before. Supercomputers are now so powerful, they perform billions of mathematical functions in a split second. But the only way scientists can really make sense of all that data is to transform those billions of numbers into visual images. This process of visualization is not only a new method of doing science, it is literally a new way of looking at the world. And isn't it ironic that it took the development of enormously powerful supercomputers to lead us to the realization that the human brain is best at recognizing patterns in picture form? At first glance, the drug research lab at Eli Lilly and Company in Indianapolis fits the traditional image of such places. Test tubes, beakers, and white coats. But among these well-worn tools of the trade is something very new, a workstation connected to a $12 million supercomputer. Of course, drug designers like Dave Herron have been gazing at computer images for many years now. What's new is that for the first time, the computer is powerful enough to animate in three dimensions how molecules really interact inside the human body. On this cutting edge of drug research, the supercomputer has become a laboratory unto itself.
The way molecules really are is that they're complex and beautiful shapes, and they're in constant motion. And it's only now that we can actually look at a computer screen and see an image that is doing all of the same things that the actual molecule would be doing if you could look at it through one of these microscopes that don't exist yet.
Scientists and students around the world are looking at things never seen before, and they can thank a visionary named Larry Smarr for putting this new technology into their hands.
He's a very inspiring guy. Larry is one of these people that just makes you feel excited and makes you want to go to work.
Larry Smarr is the director of the National Center for Supercomputing Applications at the University of Illinois, one of four such places he persuaded Congress to create in 1985. Its mission? To explore a vast new terrain and a new language in which computers are now actually powerful enough to approach the mathematical complexity of nature itself.
Nature, somehow or other, is doing a lot of calculations per second to make all this stuff happen in real world. And you can't get by if you want to create something that approximates that detail that we see in the real world of nature, unless you have a computer that's capable of billions of calculations a second.
Now, a computer is a sophisticated calculator. You punch in numbers and equations, it spits out answers. Supercomputers are simply the fastest, most powerful computers available at any one time. But until the mid-1980s, the U.S. government limited access to supercomputers almost exclusively to scientists simulating nuclear explosions and designing nuclear weapons. In fact, so tight were the restrictions that Dr. Smar and many others like him ended up studying abroad in order to use supercomputers for their basic research.
There were all these Americans sitting over there in Munich in the beer gardens and, you know, working like crazy and having a hell of a good time. And our German host one time said, aren't you ashamed of yourselves? I mean, why you Americans are supposedly so great? You make this wonderful technology of supercomputers. Why do you have to come to Germany to get access to them, to do basic research? Well, it was like the emperor's new clothes. Nobody had called the question. So I said, boy, that's a good question.
Really?
And I went back. We worked with Congress. We worked with the administration. And we came up with a national plan to put supercomputers back in the hands of academic researchers through the establishment of national supercomputing centers. As a result, maybe in 1985, there were a few hundred academics, researchers who used supercomputers. Today, there are over 10,000. We've essentially rebuilt America's human resource pool in using supercomputers and visualization to attack everything, from chemistry to astronomy to engineering to art.
To create ever faster supercomputers, breakthroughs have become commonplace. Conventional supercomputers can now perform between 2 and 4 billion calculations per second. But why stop there? Companies like Cray Research, Intel, IBM, and Thinking Machines are rushing to build supercomputers capable of more than a trillion calculations a second. And scientists have found that the only way they can possibly channel this gushing stream of data is to transform the numbers into brilliant moving pictures, like this visualization of a developing thunderstorm, or the aerodynamics of a Harrier jet landing on an aircraft carrier, or this animation of global climate change.
It enabled us to take a million numbers and to produce just one image. So you could take a million to one gulp out of this fire hose by changing it from the number to the image.
This single moving image of a supersonic jet flow represents about a billion calculations.
Oh, that's right. Look at this. Now we have the full scale, real time motion of what's happening.
Speaking of striking images, here's a rare view. Mexico City and a few of the beautiful mountains that surround it on an unusually clear Sunday afternoon. How unusual? Here's the same view of the city on a typical weekday afternoon. The difference is smog. It's little wonder that some Mexicans take extraordinary measures to deal with this deepening environmental crisis.
With a huge population, lots of cars, a geographical condition which allows the emissions to cook, that's the recipe for making poor air quality of the type that we can see today.
Greg McRae is a chemical engineer at Carnegie Mellon University.
Your eye can spot errors much, much faster than you can find them by looking at the numbers.
Dr. McRae is working with Mexican scientists to visualize the city's air pollution. He's taking their field data and entering it into a supercomputer back in Pittsburgh. Mathematician Susana Gomez knows how crucial this project is.
It's a health problem. If we want to go on living in this city, Mexico City, we have to solve this pollution problem now.
The problem is here. Cars, trucks, and buses spew out most of the city's air pollution. The result? Mexico City surpasses acceptable ozone levels 4 out of every 5 days a year. That's more than twice as often as Los Angeles. An ever-exploding population, now 17 million, makes the task of pollution control all the more daunting. But for Greg McRae, it's the perfect supercomputer challenge.
That's the exciting part.
It's a challenge he's met once before. The 43-year-old native Australian is a veteran of the toughest air pollution battle in the United States, deciding what to do about Los Angeles smog. With Larry Smarr's team, McRae and his colleagues made this influential supercomputer animation of air pollution in Southern California. McRae showed public officials how ozone clouds linger in the LA basin over several days, trapped by swirling winds and weather patterns. He broke new ground by emphasizing the role of nitrogen oxide in creating smog. And this model clearly demonstrates what the impact would be of various kinds of control.
A particularly good example of the power of visualization that there was a member of one of the air quality management boards. He'd in the past just seen numbers and contour maps and sort of just very sterile ways of presenting the information. What we did was to do a visualization, and she sort of sat up like this and said, "That's where I live."
As a result, McRae's model is the scientific underpinning for the current Los Angeles Air Quality Management Plan, the most stringent set of air pollution guidelines in the U.S.
How long will it take a city like Los Angeles or Mexico City to clean up the air?
If you think of Los Angeles, it's taken over 20 years to get where they are now. I suspect in Mexico City that it's going to take a similar length of time to control the problem. But the critical part is that there is a commitment to start.
One symbolic step taken by Mexican President Salinas was the shutdown last year of the city's huge state-run oil refinery. Another bold but controversial move was to buy an $8 million supercomputer for the National University, in part to study the environment.
Supercomputers are extremely expensive. How can a university or a government justify that?
Just to give you a very simple example, in the United States alone, we spend over $30 billion a year just on air pollution controls. If we can shave just 10% of the cost of control, we can pay for these machines in days. They are extraordinarily cost-effective in solving very, very pressing social problems.
Based on the Mexico City field data, McRae and his colleagues at the Pittsburgh Supercomputing Center created this visualization. It shows how air pollution gets trapped by the mountains that surround the city. The man who guided McRae with the groundbreaking Los Angeles animation sees great things ahead.
I think he's doing a tremendous service to not just to Mexico, but if this works, perhaps to the entire developing world. So if we can put this on the machine, train the people to use it, they have an incredibly powerful policy tool that they can use.
One, two, three, four, five, six. Okay, you six, over on that side. The rest of you are on this side, over here.
For children with asthma, like these at a special camp near Indianapolis, supercomputers are also a powerful tool in the efforts to design a better drug for this often frightening disease.
It's very difficult to breathe, and you just get very scared that you're going to be like this for a long time.
To design such a drug using a supercomputer is the goal of Dave Herron at Eli Lilly.
Your lungs get stiff and they get fluid in them, and you just can't breathe easily. It takes a lot of effort to push air in and out of your lungs. They're rigid.
Certain molecules in the lungs are the cause of that rigidity. So Herron's job is to create a drug that will block them and keep them from producing the asthma symptoms. To visualize this molecular football on a supercomputer is a form of high adventure.
You feel like an explorer because you're diving in three dimensions into this space and looking at something that nobody's ever seen before. The images are so vivid and so brilliant and clear, and the things that you see are so revealing about the way the molecules look that it's just breathtaking. And you really feel like I imagine an explorer would look coming on a piece of terrain for the first time and being the first man to look out over the Grand Canyon or something like that.
2 years ago, Eli Lilly became the first pharmaceutical company to install its own supercomputer. It was a gamble that Lilly was willing to take only after its researchers had learned the ropes from Larry Smarr's visualization virtuosos.
We have no intention of replacing the laboratory, but to produce a major multi-hundred million dollar a year drug that is a you know, benefiting a great number of people, drug companies have to go through something like 10 to 50,000 compounds to sort through them in with test tubes and rats and stuff like that to figure out whether this has any effect. Well, ultimately, this is all chemistry. So in a sense, we can help look for the wheat and the chaff with a supercomputer and visualization and perhaps cut a year or two off of that drug design development cycle.
11-year-old David Williams knows it could mean a better asthma pill.
It would be real small and easy to swallow. Last real long. So he wouldn't end up missing a lot of stuff to play.
A terrifying earthquake shakes San Francisco and Oakland, October 17th, 1989. 62 people die, $6 billion in damage. What actually triggers a quake is a complex riddle of nature, one that will not submit easily even to the most powerful supercomputers. That doesn't keep scientists from trying to solve it. In this valley northeast of Los Angeles, where the San Gabriel Mountains meet the Mojave Desert, is a telltale sign of this great mystery.
This is a rather special place we're in. It looks like an unassuming creek bed not far from the mountains. In fact, we're standing right now in the Rift Valley of the San Andreas Fault.
Really, this is it.
As a matter of fact, you could take that shovel and expose it right here. You don't have to work too hard, actually.
Well, I see a big crack already.
The crack is the result of a powerful earthquake on January 19th, 1857, that shook the state from Los Angeles to Sacramento. It continues to offer clues to Greg Leisinger, a geophysicist at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory in Pasadena.
In fact, you're sitting on the North American plate. I am on the Pacific plate. And if an earthquake were to occur while we sit here, you'd suddenly be thrust 10 or 15 feet to the right while I'd take a ride this way.
Beyond that one simple hypothesis about earthquakes, the scientific path is fraught with contradictions.
No two sections of the San Andreas Fault seem to be quite the same. Mm. In this particular location, we have earthquakes repeating every 140 years or so. Not too many miles to the north of here, we find locations where earthquakes recur every couple of decades or so. Wow.
Now, back in the Jet Propulsion Lab, Leisinger and his colleagues use the supercomputer to visualize those patterns of recurrence and to experiment with different theories about what causes earthquakes, experiments for which there is no other laboratory but the supercomputer.
So you have the Pacific plate on the left, a fault line between, and the North American plate on the right.
That's right.
The visualization shows how pressure builds up between two plates and releases that pressure in the form of a quake. The supercomputer can take centuries of this complex earthquake data and condense it into a series of colorful snapshots. The visualization is yet another testament to the influence of Larry Smarr. It was Smarr's team that provided Leisinger with the software he needed, free of charge, through a vast national telecommunications network that parallels the phone lines we use every day. It is simply Smarr's way of spreading the wealth.
So many people said, well, gee, I'd like that for my machine. Could you send me a copy? Well, I mean, it just got to be too big a job because we're not a company. And so we decided, well, why don't we just use the network itself? So we just put copies of all of the software on the network. And from your personal computer, you don't have to call us or anything. You just log on. And if you like it, you just download it to your machine and you're using it. So it's not only free, but you don't have to call. You don't have to fill out forms. It's totally invisible to us. And we've had over 60,000 downloads of our software as a result of that over the last 2 years.
43-year-old Larry Smarr is himself an astrophysicist who's been using supercomputers to visualize the behavior of black holes.
The most important thing that this is going to lead to is the development of the intuitive sense of our science. General relativity has always been a science for mathematicians. Most physics, you do with your gut. And it's been very difficult for us in general relativity to do that. And I think this is going to be a real breakthrough.
While scientists use supercomputers to make pictures from piles of data, others use them just to make pictures.
In one day, Americans use enough toothpaste to encircle the globe.
In 1 week, we use enough cans and bottles to wrap the Earth four times.
In 1 year, 2 billion razors.
In 1 year, 2 billion batteries. In 1 year, 14 million tons of cardboard boxes.
14 million tons of cardboard boxes.
Its creator is a young artist named Donna Cox, who collaborates with the scientists in Larry Smarr's computer labs. Together, they visualize all kinds of data. Every
Sunday. Artists are very important to scientific visualization because we're the visual experts of the culture. We know about form, we know about geometry, and we know how to take these techniques and apply them to the numbers to make images that reveal information.
Some of this work is in fact a marriage of art and science, like this one, created with an astrophysicist. It shows how gases stream out of the center of distant galaxies. Pictures like these lead Donna Cox to compare this kind of collaboration between artists and scientists to the Renaissance.
Renaissance artists believed that the visual study of nature could in fact reveal the hidden laws of nature. And that's what we're doing today. Artists and scientists working together, we're visually studying natural phenomena to understand and be able to predict this phenomenon.
But sometimes, even with a supercomputer, all you really want to do is have fun. For example, take this fanciful animation by another artist called Panspermia. Supercomputers offer another form of inspiration as well.
I want to go to college and major in computer science.
That's great. That's great. That's just what we need more of.
Through a national program called SuperQuest, Larry Smarr attracts top high school students to his center, where they can do some high-performance computing of their own.
The title of my program is Computer Simulated Random Diffusion Processing. It is about the fusion of gas.
3 weeks of those students being at our center using everything we have. And I must say, they are doing things more advanced on our computers than I would say probably 3/4 of the scientists, the research scientists that are using our center. Those scientists could learn a lot from those high school kids.
This Alabama teacher sees the impact of the supercomputer experience.
For our students at this age to see what, you know, this high-tech stuff can do, they can see the possibilities that they have, that they can jump into now when they go to college and be way ahead of everyone else. That's what I see for them. I wish I had known about it.
One hope is that by the introduction of personal computers with scientific visualization, you can literally create a chemistry laboratory, an astronomy laboratory, a biology laboratory, and it's all just on a personal computer. It's the software and the visualization that create an interactive environment for the child to explore science.
Greg McRae has his sights set on pioneering the use of supercomputers and visualization to address pollution crises around the world.
Can we use these ideas in places like Santiago, Shanghai, in Australia? Transfer the technology throughout the world, collaborate with the scientists in each of the countries, take their unique skills and strengths, and so that we increase the community of people who can use supercomputers and visualization to solve, you know, pressing social problems like air pollution or water pollution.
Using the same tools, Greg Leisinger wants to unravel a basic but terrifying enigma of nature. Even if it means finding out, as he suspects, that earthquakes occur with more randomness than we might like to believe.
Why would one earthquake wait for 300 years to occur, whereas another would repeat after only 50 years?
And Dave Herron grapples with molecules in designing drugs with ever greater precision and speed.
We're like little carpenters and architects. We design these molecules using the results of all of our computer work, and then we just walk a few feet into the laboratory and make them. And these are our potential new therapies for tomorrow. And having that power to be able to see it and design the molecules and then actually make them, is really exciting.
On the horizon for all of them, and ultimately for all of us, is what Larry Smarr has dubbed metacomputers.
What we're seeing today, I believe, is a transition from a world that we were familiar with in the 80s, where each of us had a standalone computer on our desk that we used. So one person, one computer, to a situation where a person, through their personal computer, out through the network to all these other computers, is effectively using a metacomputer, a computer of computers. So when you use your personal computer, it's like you're plugging your hairdryer into the wall. You don't think of all of the power grids and substations and generators. You just dry your hair. And that's what we'd like to get to, that your personal computer simply becomes a window into knowledge space, and you ask that something be done, and it's done. And you don't know that it's, in fact, this vast metacomputer that is making it happen.
Larry Smarr admits that he and his colleagues are still working on the hardware and the software for all of this. But if you wake up one morning and find yourself accessing supercomputers as effortlessly as you dry your hair, you'll have people like Larry Smarr to thank for it.
We've come so far, yet it's as if each new discovery only opens newer windows of possibilities, leading to even greater discoveries. And it seems that where we are now is only the tip of the iceberg. I'm Bill Curtis. Thanks for watching this special presentation of the New Explorers. Excuse me, but I'm going to go plug in my hairdryer.